search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and you put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your love. And oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. And I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley, and there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. No, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. No, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. No, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
Well, loved ones, friends, and family, we are gathered here this morning to celebrate Casey's life, to honor her and to glorify our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. As we gather, I always like to begin by taking a look at the 23rd Psalm and by dedicating our time that we're going to spend here for a little while gathered together to the Lord. Let's go before the Lord. Father God, we thank you for this time, Lord. We thank you that we can be here. We pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would move in this place. God, we ask that you would bring comfort, that you would bestow peace, that you would honor and glorify yourself in this place. God, that you would bring, as your word declares, the comfort with which we might comfort one another. Lord, we pray that you bless this day and you bless our efforts as we lift them to you in Jesus' name. Amen. In the 23rd Psalm, we have a scripture written by a Hebrew teenager as he sat over his flocks, as he pondered life out in the wilderness, as he was ostracized by his family. He was the youngest. He got all the jobs nobody else wanted to do. That's how that works. And so as he gathered in that place, we still, more than 2,000 years later, read his words, the words that he penned in that place. He wrote this: "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." He's declaring that everything that we need is the Lord. He meets all those needs. In fact, when Moses stood before the Lord and he was being sent back into Egypt to gather the children, Moses said, "Whom shall I say is sending me? If I just show up and say, 'God told me,' you know, people look at you funny. Who shall I say?" The Lord said, "Tell them, I am that I am. The Yahweh, I am, has sent you." The 23rd Psalm begins with that phrase. We translate it with the word Lord. The Yahweh, he is everything I need. He is the becoming one. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. It is he who restores my soul. The place that we are looking for today for our comfort, our peace, our hope is to him. For it is he, as our shepherd, who has led us to this place. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I will walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil because you are with me. At that point, the psalmist stops writing in the third person, lifts his eyes to the heavens, and he begins to write directly, "Lord, you are with me." He's going to say, "Your rod, your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. And surely, goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." One of the beautiful things when we gather is to look at the wakes, the things that we leave behind. The psalmist wrote, "Surely goodness and mercy will be my wake. These will be the things that follow me." I believe these were the things that followed Casey. I believe these are the things that follow Weston and the family. I believe this is our goal, that when we pass through a place, we leave goodness and mercy behind. And we hold on to the hope and promise that we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
to soften my heart and break me apart. I need you to open my eyes and see that you're shaping my life. And all I am, I surrender. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. And I'm broken inside, I give you my life. And I need you to soften my heart and break me apart. I need you to pierce through the dark and cleanse every part of me. And all I am, I surrender. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. And I'm broken inside, and I give you my life. And I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. So give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. And I'm broken inside, and I give you my life. And I need you to soften my heart and break me apart. I need you to open my eyes and see that you're shaping my life.
Casey went to join her Heavenly Father on Father's Day, June 21st, 2020, after a long-fought battle with breast cancer. Casey is a cherished child of God who loved our Lord and Savior. Those who knew Casey remember her passion for sharing our Savior's truth, grace, and mercy in an inspiring and encouraging way to everyone she had an opportunity to have a conversation with. Many of the doctors and nurses who cared for Casey were surprised by Casey's endless faith as she always shared that God is on the throne and in control. During this battle with cancer, Casey touched so many of us. We could see the God-given courage, strength, and perseverance in her as she was always giving words of hope, encouragement, and sharing about Jesus. During Casey's last few days of her life, her only concern was that we know Jesus Christ so that our salvation is secure. She was always incredibly focused that family and friends have a meaningful relationship with Jesus Christ. Casey Lynn Rowe was born on January 29, 1985 in Twin Falls to Joe and Janet Rowe. Casey brought joy to her family from the time she was born. She was her mom's sidekick from early on, joining Janet as Janet traveled to play softball. Meanwhile, Casey's dad, cousins, and uncles taught her about rodeo. Casey's parents both taught her how to compete in sports, and as a result, Casey was active in sports at an early age. She developed a natural talent for girls' rodeo events, participating in 5 events from the early age of 8. Casey spent a lot of time with her grandfather, Joe Rowe. He taught her to drive him around the town of Wendell by the age of 12. She learned to rope and ride and developed her love for horses during the time she spent with her grandpa and grandma Rowe and her uncles and cousins in Wendell. Casey was the only granddaughter on the Rosa side of her family and had a special relationship with her grandma Rosa. She was always determined not to be treated as a girl and never held back while playing with her cousins Adam and Zach. She spent many fun summer days on the Snake River in Burley with her grandpa Rosa, her uncle Mark, and her cousins. Casey did not like the water, but went for grandpa's entertainment to see if he could dump them off the float tubes. Janet and her sister Carla loved to go shopping in Boise. Casey always went along with them, sometimes playing hide and seek in the clothes rack. Casey was good at hiding, which sometimes created stress on her mom and aunt as they frantically tried to find her. One time while shopping with her mom, Aunt and Grandma Rosa, Casey and Grandma got disoriented in the mall. Although Casey was only 5 at the time, she comforted her grandma that her mom would find them. Casey knew this would be true because her mom always found her when she was hiding. How could she not find them when they were sitting in the open waiting to be found? Casey's little brother Jared was born in 1993. Casey and Jared had a fierce bond. Jared loved to support his big sister when she was participating in rodeo, and later Casey returned the favor by being there for Jared. As the big sister, Casey was always Jared's protector. Casey had a determined spirit and attitude. When she set her mind on something, there was no stopping her. Her little brother Jared was often on one end or the other of these adventures. He was always there to help Casey no matter what she asked him to do. Casey had a special black horse by the name of Kizzy. Kizzy is in the picture with Casey on the program. It was amazing to see how this horse adored Casey. They had a distinctive relationship. Kizzy would follow Casey around without any tether or rope, similar to a trained dog. It was almost like the horse longed for the relationship and was as competitive as Casey. Through their performance efforts, Kizzy earned the Idaho High School Rodeo Horse of the Year Award in 2002. Casey was spoiled by Kizzy and expected all of her other horses to be like Kizzy. However, that was not to be the case. One evening, Casey told Jared to clean out the horse stall, so he dumped the horse stuff in a couple of big piles in the middle of the arena to be tilled in later to the soil. Casey had told Jared that she did not have time to help since she needed to ride her horse named Lark, a Palomino mare that her grandpa Roe had given Casey when they were both little. Lark's personality was a whole lot more stubborn than Casey's and a whole lot different than Kizzy's. Casey was aboard Lark, riding her around the arena, when a loud squeal was heard. Joe, Janet, and Jared found Casey face first in the fresh manure pile. Casey skinned her cheek up but was otherwise just fine after Lark gave Casey a flying dismount. Casey had a few more run-ins with Lark, still trying to get her to perform. Most of the time, Lark gave Casey a flying dismount, and Lark would then run down the rest of the arena, bucking in joy that she had dumped Casey off. Casey graduated from Kimberly High School in 2003. Casey qualified to go to the National High School Finals Rodeo in 2001 and 2002. Casey also played basketball and volleyball in high school and was fortunate to have her mom coach her in Little League basketball. Casey attended the College of Southern Idaho and then went on to Idaho State University, participating on the rodeo teams at both schools. Casey qualified to go to the College National Finals in 2009. Casey loved horses and continued to ride as time would permit. After graduating from college, where she earned a teaching degree, Casey taught business classes at the Buell High School for several years. She also coached the girls' JV basketball team for a year. Casey's son Kaiser was born in 2007. Casey embraced being a mom and loved Kaiser with all her heart, taking him along on all her adventures. Casey and Kaiser moved at least 7 times as Casey completed her education. Moving was always an adventure that included Casey's mom, dad, Jared, of course, and a few of the times, Grandma and Grandpa Rosa. One time when she moved into an apartment in Pocatello to attend Idaho State University, Casey and Grandpa were very determined to shove her couch through the front door. They worked at different angles, both working up a sweat, but that couch would not fit. Grandma had been unpacking a box and came to the rescue by simply suggesting that they just take off the legs of the couch, and bingo, it went right in. Casey met Pam Howard in 2007 through Casey's friendship with Pam's daughter, Jessie. Casey and Pam formed a special bond, and in 2007, shortly after Kaiser was born, Pam's love for the Lord poured into Casey. Over the years, Casey's faith grew as Pam continued to nurture and minister to Casey. At a funeral service in 2008 that she attended with her parents, Casey heard that salvation is assured for everyone who believes in Jesus Christ. At that moment, she knew Christ was real. Casey shared that memory with her mom a few months ago. In the fall of 2014, Casey was introduced by friends at Calvary Chapel Buell to the love of her life, Weston Becker. Casey was diagnosed with breast cancer in October 2014. Weston embraced Casey's medical diagnosis and determined she was for him, no matter what the battle and storms they would face due to the cancer. They were married on November 25th, 2014, at Calvary Chapel Buell with Pastor Jackie officiating. The wedding was put together quickly by friends and family, but there was no reception. Most of us remember Casey and Weston made the decision to get married just 2 days prior to being married due to upcoming meetings with doctors for treatment for Casey's cancer. You talk about Weston Becker being all in for Casey. Wow, that is God-inspired love, is all her family could say. Casey had surgery in December 2014 to remove the cancer, and they discovered at that time God had blessed them with a pregnancy. Following the birth of Elizabeth in August of 2015, they were then blessed with the addition of Abigail in September 2016 and then Joshua in January 2018. Elizabeth, Abigail, and Joshua's birth were all big blessings for Weston and Casey. She loved each of them very much. They were the lights of her life. Casey and Weston would often laugh about Abigail's birth. They decided to have the birth in Boise. Weston didn't realize how close he came to having to deliver Abigail himself on the drive. Fortunately, they made it into the hospital just in the nick of time. After a quick check-in in a hospital bed, including a run into the wall by the nurse on the way to the delivery room, Abigail was born 15 minutes after arriving at the hospital. Weston was definitely thanking the Lord that they made it on time. He was grateful that the Lord provided what was needed at the right time, so that Weston did not have to do the delivery by himself on the side of the road. Casey developed many faithful friendships through Calvary Chapel Buell. Including many close and special friendships. She enjoyed her trips with her girlfriends and their time of fellowship. We are so thankful that these ladies came alongside Casey during this time. She treasured each and every one of you. Casey's mom is thankful for the opportunity that the Lord created for her to be available to care for Casey and the children during the last 16 months. They enjoyed discussing their Bible study fellowship lessons and how timely God's word and truth is in any situation. Casey taught Janet how to fix some of the family's favorite foods and shared some of her favorite scriptures during this time together. This was a time created by God for mom and daughter to get reacquainted and talk about their faith and trust in Jesus. Only our Father God could have created such a time. Casey had a radiant smile, a love for others, an incredible love for our Savior Jesus Christ. She was always quick to share God's truth, grace, and mercy. We will all miss her as she helped us to be accountable to Christ. She did ask for all of us that knew her to remind Weston and the children how much Casey loved Jesus for what he did for us, and also how much she loved each of them. Casey is survived by her husband, Weston, her children, Kaiser, Elizabeth, Abigail, and Joshua Becker, her brother, Jared Rowe, her parents, Joe and Janet Rowe, and her grandmothers, Donna Rowe and Arlene Rosa, as well as many aunts, uncles, and cousins. She was preceded in death by her grandfathers, Joe Rowe and Vernon Rosa.
You bless. to me. The person that I've been lately ain't who I wanna be. But you stay here right beside me. Watch as the storm blows through and I need you. God gave me you for the ups and downs. God gave me you for the days of doubt. For when I think I've lost my way, there are no words here left to say it's true. the melody you surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears have gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. place I'd rather be. No place I'd rather be. No place I'd rather be than hearing your love, hearing your love. No place I'd rather be. No place I'd rather be. No place I'd rather be than hearing your love, hearing your love. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. No place I'd rather be. No place I'd rather be. No place I'd rather be than hearing your love, hearing your love. No place I'd rather be. No place I'd rather be. No place I'd rather be than hearing your love, hearing your love. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, I can't control. Down on more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul. I can't contain, I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God.
I can tell you again this morning, that's one thing that Casey wanted to make sure for each and every one of you, that you understood that which she possessed, which was that strength of the Lord in her life. Jesus was approached by a wise man in John chapter 3 who didn't understand how this whole thing of following God was supposed to look. And Jesus was amazed. Aren't you the teacher? Aren't you the one who teaches the nation? Do you not know? A man must be born again. Place his hope and trust in the Lord. And here's the exciting thing. Throughout Scripture, from Genesis to Revelation, the Lord asks this question. Isaiah 55. Come, everyone who thirsts, come unto the water. He who has no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money, without price. For why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, or your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me and eat what is good. Delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear that your soul may live, and I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. You remember him, right? The Lord is my shepherd. Behold, I made him a witness to the people, a leader, a commander for the people. Behold, you will call a nation you do not know and a nation that did not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God and of the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have compassion upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there, but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word that goes out of my mouth, it will not return to me empty. It will accomplish that which I purpose and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy. You shall be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hill will break forth in the singing. The trees of the field will clap their hands. Instead of the thorn will come the cypress. Instead of the briar, the myrtle. And it shall make a name for the Lord, an everlasting covenant that shall not be cut off. The Bible tells us in days like today, as we celebrate Casey, we will shed tears. It's okay. But we don't mourn as those who have no hope. We mourn as those who have hope. Who have hope in the promises of the resurrection, Jesus Christ. John chapter 11, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will never die. Bible teaches two paths, a road of the fool and the road of the wise. The road of the fool leads to death. The road of the wise leads to life. Jesus Christ, in Proverbs chapter 8, as signified as the wisdom of God, calls men to follow him. Follow me. Come follow me. What did Jesus say when he came? Come follow me. Come walk the path of life. Why? Because when we follow Jesus, we never die. We move. Casey's not here. But she is with life. And that life, according to John chapter 1, is the light of all men. She is with Jesus Christ. Our hope as we mourn is that we one day too will see his face, be given the crown of righteousness and a cloak that covers all our failures as he presents us without fault before the Lord. And then the word promises us this. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. The sea was no more. The sea is a symbol in Scripture of the scary things. You remember when you were a kid and the monster that was under your bed or in your closet? So you go to sleep and you had to get up and close the door. Or when you turned out your light, you had to run and jump in bed for what was coming out from under the bed. For the nation of Israel, that was the sea. The sea's the scary place where the beast comes from. He says, there'll be no more sea, no more scary things, no more frightful things. He saw a holy city, New Jerusalem, coming from heaven, prepared like a bride, adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne say, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them. They will be his people, God himself will be with them as their God. Listen, and he will, what's he promise? Wipe away how many tears? Every tear. Every pain. Sometimes we wonder the pain we've lived through. What about that? No, the Lord says, I will wipe away every tear. Every pain. All gone. Death will be no more. Neither will there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain. For the former things have passed away. And he who is seated on the throne, that's Jesus Christ, declared, behold, I am making how many things new? All things new. All things. This is our hope. Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. He said, it is finished. I am the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end. To the thirsty I will give from the spring of the water of life without payment. The one who conquers will have this heritage. I will be his God, and he will be my son. To the one who conquers, 1 John tells us, the one who conquers is the one who places his faith in Jesus Christ. We don't conquer by ability or our own strength. We conquer by faith, trusting in him. So, Revelation 22 declares, the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the one who hears say, come. And let the one who is thirsty come. And the one who desires take of the water of life without price is free. He who testifies these things says, surely I am coming soon. So, even so, come, Lord Jesus. May the grace of the Lord Jesus be with you all. Amen.
Trust. Casey Becker, a story by Pam Howard, who is here with us today, but due to a recent surgery, is unable to speak. There are events in life that take knowledge from the head to the heart. Casey's life has changed me. In her passing, God has changed me. I first met Casey almost 15 years ago. She participated in college rodeo with my daughter, Jessica. They became friends, and she subsequently followed Jesse home that summer to help her manage a group of pasture yearling cattle. She loved the horses and ranch environment. That fall, after going back to college, unbeknownst to each other, they both found themselves pregnant. In excited anticipation, both girls came home to live with my husband and I. There were supposedly 2 weeks difference in their due dates, which ended up being only 2 days. The following June, both children were born, both boys. A joyful, chaotic time ensued. It was during this time she became one of my kids. We loved Casey. Casey always had a driven, passionate personality. In everything she did, she gave her whole heart to. Sometime during the following year, still living with us, she gave her heart to the Lord and she fell in love. True love changes things, and Casey began to change. A different light filled her eyes, and she developed a deep compassion for those hurting around her. Like all of us, she wasn't perfect, and when she stumbled, asking forgiveness, she stood up and walked forward in her relationship with God and those around her. Casey's confidence grew, and everywhere she went, she talked about her faith. After moving to Buell, she started several prayer groups and Bible studies at the apartment complexes she lived in. She was the one in her sphere of relationships that people came to for encouragement. Early on, she developed a desire to go into ministry. She often became frustrated because people thought she was too young. I smile when I remember her frequent impatience at what she thought the speed of God's answering direction should be. We shared a mutual faith and love for the Lord, and through trials and joys, we continued to share each other's lives. She was ready to find someone she could share her dreams with and was anxious to start dating, but this time she said, "I want to do it God's way." Several times she would tell me, "I met this guy," and I would ask her, "Is he a believer?" "Well, no, but he's nice." I told her, "God is preparing you for the perfect guy, just like he's preparing him, the guy, for you. When that day arrives, you will know." Little did I know I was about to witness the ensuing God love story between her and Weston. Even with the diagnosis of cancer, God knit them together. Weston's commitment from the very beginning was amazing. The first time Casey's mom, Janet, and I met Weston was at the doctor's office visit biopsy. Janet and I decided before Weston arrived that we would have him sit between us and give him the mother scrutiny test. He walked boldly into the setting and passed with flying colors. After all, he loved our girl. Over the past 5 years, so many people have been praying for Casey and Weston, and the thought comes to mind, why? Why, God, didn't we see a miracle of healing? We know there's no doubt that God can do it. We've asked and pled for God to heal her. We've witnessed God perform other miracles in her life. It's actually the first time in my life I begged God for anything. It was a tough couple of hours before I was finally spent and listened. God was asking me, do I trust him? Whether he heals her here on this earth or heals her through taking her home, do I trust him? God is sovereign. We don't see the big picture, and I have to believe there was some kind of glory at stake. We know God hears us, but it didn't happen. He carried her home. Then I think of the uncomprehending gift she left Weston on this Father's Day, those beautiful children. What plans does he have for them? I'm filled with hope and know for a fact that I will see her again. I look forward in anticipation to God's revelations and rest in the knowledge that Casey is now healed. And knowing her, she's not resting, but busy about the Lord's business. Remember, you are brave and smart and strong. She will be looking for us to join her. In closing, she often would encourage us to be ready. The circle of life, it is the Holy Spirit within us. We are who we are because someone ahead of us nurtured us. Life can be so difficult, but it's through others and community he gives hope. Love others and be an encouragement always to them. And have a blessed day was her saying to all she met. This is a poem also by Pam. Casey, my child, words cannot express how thankful I am your body's at rest. The gift of your presence down here on earth remains deep within us as memories birth. Now glorified in the Father, complete in him, showing us the way to ultimately win. The race that we run, steady and strong, in choices we make, for God's presence we long. To see you again, the journey complete, in love of the Savior, to rest at his feet.
I'm used to the much larger podium that used to be here. Oh, wow. God is good. I first off want to say thank you to everyone who is here today. I also want to thank all of those who have been praying for us, supporting us, loving us. We couldn't have done it without you. God heard your prayers. He is still hearing your prayers. Don't stop praying. Pam, I want to thank you also for the word that you gave as well, of what you shared. You and your family have been a big part of our lives. We thank you for your love and your support, and we know that will continue. Going back to that time going to the biopsy with both of you there, I was quite nervous that day, actually. So I was like, what did I walk into right now? But I love Casey so much that I was willing to do whatever it took to get to that day of just being able to call her my wife and to love her with everything that I had. So when I wanted to say something today as I was just preparing for it, and there was the page before me to write what I wanted to say. And I'm just like, Lord, what do you want to say today? And there the blank page was before me. So many memories, so many times of laughter, tears flooded through my mind of what would I write. What am I going to write on this piece of paper that could any way say anything that my heart was feeling at that time? I feel like the story that started a little under 6 years ago in 2014 already began before that, when both of us surrendered our lives to Christ. He was the sole purpose of our life, each of our lives, the reason for our meaning, our being, our existence. We love Jesus. So our story, as it's gone through the years, was never written by us. It was always written by the Lord. And I know it will continue to be written by Him, by His hand. So at the top of my piece of paper there, I said no script. God's already written the script. I can't write it. I can't write it for him. I can't write anything for God. He has to write it. So right below that, two things I wrote. Number one, Jesus. Always number one. For both Casey and myself, Jesus was always number one in each of our lives, in our families' lives. In our pursuit, in everything that we did, we wanted to honor Christ in what we did. And Casey modeled that for me in so many ways. Number two, I wrote down Casey. Number one, Jesus. Number two, Casey. Because these are things that I can talk on and on and on and on about, and you can't stop me. You may say something, but I don't know if I'll stop or not. So, but as I move forward with what, you know, other things that kind of flowed down the page as I continue to write, as we celebrate Casey's life today, I never want to lose sight of hope. Because this story that God has written, that he's started years ago, that he's continued to write, is a story of hope, is a story of love, is something that will live far beyond today. And I see that daily in our children's faces, in our children's lives. For Kaiser, Elizabeth, Abigail, and Joshua, their lives will be a continuation of what Casey's life was, what it exemplified, her example. And I will be there to walk them through and to remind them of how Casey lived her life every day. She didn't live her life for herself. She lived it for, number one, Christ, above all else. She lived it for others. I have never seen anyone, any person, model the love of Christ in any way that I did in Casey. She changed my life forever in how she showed me how to love. It's interesting, I've been going through and reading through just in different prayer journals and different things that Casey wrote, and I was opening my Bible and I was open to a specific portion of scripture, and I didn't realize that she had written something in my Bible. And normally I don't write a lot of things in my Bible, so but when she wrote things in my Bible, I thought that was great. But what she wrote was, is she told me this too, this is in Psalm 37. Psalm 37, verses 4 and 5. It says, "Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him, and he will act." Her note was, "I love you, Weston David. This is where our story began, founded on his word." And that's so true. Our story did begin on Christ and Christ alone. Calvary Chapel Buell holds such a special place in our hearts because this is really where it all began for us. Unbeknownst to me, I didn't know that there was someone that was interested in me, so I was just kind of going about my life as saying, Lord, it's you and me, I guess, just you and me. I don't know if it's ever going to happen, so it's just you and me, Lord. And that was okay if that was, but I'm glad it took a different road. So, and it actually, for me, is standing up at this at the pulpit here, is where a lot of it began as well. As Casey told me one time, she said, do you know who told me that I was going to marry you? And I said, no, I don't. And she told me, she said, the Holy Spirit told me that you were going to marry me. And I said, well, I can't really argue with you on that. You. And it became clear to me over time it wasn't very, very long after that, that the Lord, the Holy Spirit revealed the same thing to me. But apparently, according to what I've been told, that I'm glad the Holy Spirit did tell her, because according to, I guess, the word that was going around, I didn't have a whole lot of game, so there was going to... The Holy Spirit was going to have to work, because there was a lot of lack there, so... So I'm glad. I'm glad the Holy Spirit did the work, and because it probably wouldn't happen if I was in charge, so... But... Yeah, so the story was is that in that back door back there, that exit right over there, I was up here and I was praying that morning. Before sometimes we pray and before Jackie comes up and preaches the and gives the teaches the word, and I prayed that morning, and Casey happened to be walking by that door right over there, and she heard some guy was speaking. He was praying up front, and she just, I guess, apparently, according to what I heard, her knees buckled when she heard when she heard this guy up here praying. I don't know, but I'll take it. So she said she knew. She said that whoever that guy is, that's the man I'm supposed to marry. So as we, you know, as things progressed, I was as introduced to Casey, and through mutual friends, they had to set it all up. Like I said, I have no game here. So, they set up a game night, and that was probably the first time that I really was around Casey, and. You know, unbeknownst to me, I thought, hey, something is really going on here. This setting this game up night, hey, man, you really got to come tonight. I'm like, what is this, you know? It's like, so I went to the game night, you know. Yeah, sure, this will be fun, you know. And so I get there, and we're going through the night, and everybody's kind of moving along, and okay, something is going on here. It's a little bit different, but... Like the night ended, and I had fun. I think we all had fun that night, and I was getting ready to leave, and I was gonna walk. Casey was standing right over at the counter in their house, Jason and Danielle's house, and she was right by the corner. And I get to the doorway, and I'm like, I'm walking out the doorway. I'm going. Something, the Lord, stopped me right at that door. And he said, you need to talk to her. I'm like, oh man, what am I gonna say? And so, you know, I stopped and I talked to her for a little bit, and you know, general conversation. And so then I think that's really where it began, and it kind of continued on for that. We had some more game nights and everything like that, and it progressed, and then a lot of it turned to, and that's why I say this church has so much meaning for me and for Casey. It had so much, even when I'm here, there are so many memories that flood through my mind with Casey and myself. We would come, we'd go to church together, we'd come to Bible studies together, And then we would actually end up out in the parking lot talking to one another really late. Our soul, we were just so excited about Jesus, that was our primary conversation, was about Christ. I love to be able to sit and talk with Casey about Jesus Christ, about our life, after we were married, about our life and everything. We love to spend so much time just talking together, just spending time and talking. And that, for me, was one of the most rewarding things in my life, was to be able to have that close relationship with my wife, that we could just sit and we could talk together. So even like it was said before in some of the other things that were said, I was that before we were married, Casey was diagnosed with cancer. But probably in this whole time that I'm going to talk up here, the word cancer's only, this will be the last time that I mention it, because cancer doesn't have the victory. Jesus has the victory. And Casey's life is an example of that, and you'll see that as I move forward, that Casey's life has an example that that disease did not win. It will never win when Jesus is involved. So I did, you know, I never had, when I heard that it was on October 31st, 2014, when she was given the diagnosis. I remember being at work that day, and she called me, and then they had the Hallelujah night here for everyone to come and for the kids and everything, and we sat in a room in the back, I remember it, and we just cried together. We cried together over that, but I loved her, and it was never a question in my mind that I was not going to walk through whatever it would be with her. So we moved forward, and on November 25th, 2014, we were married, husband and wife, right up here. For me, one of the happiest, most joyful days of my life. I will never forget it. I married the most amazing woman that I had ever met in my life. The most beautiful woman I had ever met in my life. Even in the short time, even before we were married, she'd already had such a huge impact on my life that I could never see my life going forward without her there. And when we got married, the foundation was on Christ and Christ alone. And throughout our marriage, all the way to the end, it was Christ and Christ alone was the true foundation. One of Casey's scriptures that both of us really cling to as we went through the years is the story of our lives as it went through the years. It just amazes me, because I don't see how anyone but God could have written, has been writing the story. I could have never thought any of these things up in our lives that have happened to us, or how they've happened. And there's a lot of trying, hard times in the last almost little over 5.5 years. I mean, there was a lot of hard times, tiring times. But we knew that Christ, that the Lord, was there with us there every step of the way. And one of those scriptures that Casey really clung to, and as I did as well, but this was one that she would always go to, and it's in 2 Corinthians 12:9. And this is Jesus who's saying, Jesus says this first part right here, he says this to the Apostle Paul: "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. And then the Apostle Paul went on and he said, therefore I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Casey really recognized and understood that very well of God's grace, of how sufficient it was in those times when you're thinking, is the ship going down? Are we sinking? No, the grace of God is sufficient. He will keep us going. He will keep us moving. He will keep us above the water. And it's in that place of knowing the sufficiency of the grace of God that you realize the power of God. And we realized and we came to really see the power of God working in our lives every day. Was it easy? No. But was it good? Yes. It was very good. And I wouldn't change anything that we walked through. I wouldn't change any of it. Because like I said before, this is God's story. This isn't mine. This isn't Casey's. And as it moves forward, it's still God's story for our kids' lives and for all those whose lives Casey has touched. God's story continues. Another scripture that really stuck out for both of us, this is why our lives, even before we were married, were rooted in this verse of Casey had this verse marked in her Bible clearly. She put a heart by it, red heart, right by this verse. This was one of her favorite scriptures, one of mine as well. She always told the girls, because the heart was there, that's Daddy's verse. So they always want to see Daddy's verse. They want to go see the heart because that's where Daddy's verse is. That was Casey's verse. It's Galatians 2:20. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. We gave our lives up. Casey and I, we gave our lives up to Christ. And that's what we said. It's no longer each of us who lives, but it's Christ who lives in us. We wanted to teach that to our children, the same thing. Because we know that Christ radically changed our lives, and we knew he would do the same things, and he will do the same things in our children's lives. We also believe that he will do that in anyone's life. Anyone. That's the great thing about Jesus Christ, is he calls whoever, and it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter who you are, he's calling. And I think as I'm moving here towards the end and towards closing, it was something that Casey would always, she would tell me a lot of times, because probably the kind of guy I am, I always gotta think things through. I gotta sit down and make a plan. I gotta write this out. I gotta have down there on a piece of paper where I can see it. And so here's the plan. This is how we're gonna do this, this, and this to get to this. A lot of times she'd always tell me, she'd write this. I've actually read some of this. I've read it in her prayer journal as well, when she would pray for me. She'd say, Lord, help Weston not to be afraid. Help him to be bold. And she'd tell me, don't overcomplicate things. Keep it simple. I'm working on that. So right now, Casey, this is for you right now. I'm not going to be afraid, because my trust is in the Lord. And I am going to be bold right now. because I know Casey would want me to do this, because her love for people was so great. I ask you, where is the story of your life? Where are you going? What path are you on right now in your life? Do you know Christ? Because he wants to know you. He knows you. Casey learned that surrender, and I've learned surrender, to Christ is the only way. There is no other way. There is no other path. The only way to life is through Christ. The only way to victory is through Christ. The only way to hope is through Christ. There's no other way. I'm going to read John chapter 14, verses 1 through 6. This is Jesus speaking right here. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way, and you know the way where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus clearly laid it out there. There's no other way. There's no other way to the Father except through Jesus Christ. Except through Jesus Christ. That was the message that Casey would speak over and over and over again. She cared and loved people so much, she cared about their eternal salvation. Where are you today? Where are you today? And she was bold, and she was not afraid to ask people and to talk to them about it. And that's what I loved about her, is that she loved people so much. One more scripture here. And this is one that Casey, I know she lived by it when she would talk to people, and so do I. It's Romans 1:16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. For it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. To everyone who believes. Would you want to throw your weight, everything that you have, into Jesus? That's a question that's asked. Would you do that? And why? All I could say to you is that for Casey and myself, our lives speak to what we know. And what we know is when we surrendered everything to Christ, we have complete confidence in God that he will get us home. One day, he'll get us home. Casey's already realized that. She's there. One day, I'll be there. I don't doubt it for a second. I don't question it. I don't fear. I don't fear the future. I don't fear that because I know and my confidence rests in the power of God. So as I finish and I end here, I want to remind you that Casey here on earth, yes, she is gone, but she's with the Lord now forever, no end. The story doesn't end. And I don't put an end on the story because it's God's story. It's wide open right now. How's God going to work? How's God going to move? I leave that in his hands. But I go back to your story and your life. If Casey is, I know Casey touched so many lives. And this is my prayer, and I know it'll be for my life as well. Is how did Casey reach you? How did she touch you? How will you carry it forward? I know I will. I have to. It has to carry forward with me. How her life was, what it meant, what her life meant, who she was. Always pointing people to Christ. Always living for Christ. Honoring Christ. She loved Jesus with all of her heart, her soul, her mind, and her strength. Her energy, even to the very end, was for Christ. And finally, I could have given so many memories, so many things. I have so many things that I could have said about Casey, but I would have been up here for a very long time. But one final image for me that will stand out. Was 4 days before she went to be with the Lord. She'd been through all the treatments. Her body was wearing out. But her spirit was not. And Casey had a heart for worship. She would worship the Lord with her whole heart. I had never seen anybody worship like her, ever. And in all the pain and everything that was going on in her body at that time, the kids were out there watching some worship music on TV, and they were just standing there watching it. And that wasn't good enough for Casey. That wasn't good enough. You can't just stand there and watch. You have to be part. You have to join in. You have to be part of what is of the worship. You have to enter into the worship. And so she stood up out of her chair. She put her hands in the air. And she danced around. As well as she could. And she was worshiping the Lord. At the end. It didn't matter how much pain she was in. It didn't matter. Her heart was for Jesus. And she'd give it all for him. Are you willing to give everything for him? Casey did. And she said it, and I know she'd tell you right now, through everything she's been through, it was all worth it. He got her home. He got her home. She's free. She's free. No more pain, no more hurt. She's with the King. And he's holding her now. So that would be my final word. As you remember Casey, her life had so much value, so much meaning. There will never be another Casey Becker. There will never be. But who are you? There will never be another you. What will you let God do through your life, like Casey let God do through her life? Jesus is calling. All you have to do is answer. Say, here I am. You can have me. I want to do what you want me to do, Lord. That's my prayer for today. And I am going to pray because that's how it all began, and I have to pray. Oh, Lord God, Father, I thank you for Casey's life. I thank you for how you taught her how to love, that you poured out through her heart, your heart, Lord God, for people, that she could see through your eyes and see people for who they were in the place where they were, and she loved them like you love them. Oh God, give us eyes to see like Jesus, to love people. To love people, Lord God. Oh, Lord God, I pray for all of those here today. Lord God, I pray that you'll open their eyes to see and their ears to hear, Lord God, what you're saying. What Casey was always pointing to is Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is King. Let him be the King of your life. He will radically change your life. That the story of your life, though it may not be easy, it will be good. Because you can have pure and fully know confidence in God that he will direct me, he will guide me, he will get me home one day. And though this life can be hard, though this life can be painful, though this life can throw us so many curveballs and so many different things, Christ is always there for us and with us when we say, come in, Lord Jesus, come in, receive me, take me. Christ says, I don't look at what you look like. I just want you to come to me. I don't care what you've done. I just want you to come to me. No one is beyond coming to me because my power will work in their life. And my power, it's my power. That's what Jesus says. It's my power that will transform your life. But you have to let me. Father, I thank you and I praise you for your faithfulness and your goodness, Lord God, to me, that I was allowed to be Casey's husband, Lord God, that you bestowed that honor upon me to be able to call her my wife, that she is the mother of my children. She loved us well. Lord God, she loved us well. Father, help me to love my children well as she showed me how to love. Help us, Lord God, who came in contact with Casey, to love well, Lord God, those around us because of what Casey's example was. Father, I know Casey loved you so much. She gave it all for you, and she would do it again and again and again, no matter the cost. Lord, I pray that you will be glorified here today. That today is about you. It's about you showing that your power is real in a person's life. And that was Casey. You show that your power is real in people's lives. Casey showed that through her life every day. Lord God, when she gave her life to you, she showed it every day to the end. Father, we thank you and we praise you that you love us, that you died for us, that you paid the price for us, that we can have life. To you be all the glory. To you be all the praise. To you be all the majesty and splendor. To you, God Almighty, is everything. We give it into your hands, and we trust you in all things, Lord God. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
I'm teasing. I've just come to do the benediction. Jude 24, 25 says this. Now unto him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, now and forever. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for this time that we can gather, Lord. We thank you for the opportunity to be with friends and family, Lord. We thank you, God, that you are moving in this place. God, we want to lift up the reception, Lord. We want to pray that you would bless the food that is shared, the memories that are shared, the time that is shared, and Lord, in and through it all, that you would be glorified and magnified. God, we give you all glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. As we conclude the service this morning, we're going to escort the family to the fellowship hall, and then we'd invite you to follow over. We have prepared a meal for everyone who's willing to stay and wants to partake in it. You're welcome to stay and be a part of that. We also have an opportunity to have people share memories that will be videotaped and kept for the family to be able to watch, and also especially for the children to be able to watch one day, as I'm sure they will have questions about Mom, and they would love to be able to hear your memories of your time with Casey. So those things we'll have the opportunity to participate in right over in the fellowship hall. So we hope you will join us for that. God bless you. Thank you for being here. In Jesus' name, amen.